This year, many of us have realised that we need our gardens more than ever. So every week on this series, I'm delighted to invite you to my home so that we can go gardening together. A job in the garden that nobody seems to like doing is weeding. I quite like it though. I love the idea of digging, clearing soil and leaving plenty of room for the plants to grow without competition from any unwanted species. And that's what a weed is. It's a perfectly good plant, but just in the wrong place, according to you. There's two main types of weed. There's annual weeds, and they're things like stickyback. Everybody will know it. They set seed, they grow, they flower, and they die all in one year. And then there are perennial weeds. So here's an example of a perennial weed. It's a dandelion, and we recognise the foliage from that and, of course, the yellow flower, and it has a long taproot. Now, when I was digging, if I left any of that in the soil, it would propagate, it would grow again, and we'd have more dandelions. So I'm going to take this out, and I don't want to put it on the compost heap because it will grow again. So I leave that in another pile. Other examples of perennial weeds would be scotchgrass or bindweed. All of those roots need to be taken out. A very good way to weed a relatively newly planted border is to use one of these things. People have forgotten about them. They're called hoes, and they'll get any new seedlings that have germinated, and quite simply, it's going to be off with their heads. A hoe is a very good garden implement because it allows you to go in between the plants, and if you get the weed early, before it flowers, then they say you're saving yourself 7 years weeding, because of course if it flowers, it produces seed, that spreads everywhere, and you've multiple little weeds. You can use chemicals, you can use weed killers. I like to garden as organically as possible, so I go for the heavy option, lots of digging. Just taken a bit of a break from the weeding in the garden to answer a couple more questions. The first one is from Debbie, who is in Liscannor in County Clare, and she has a rather typical garden of rural Ireland coastal areas. Large clumps of Montbretia growing wild, as well as a big fuchsia hedge. And she wants to know, what could she add to the planting to cope, and this is the important bit, with the wind and the salt-laden air that rushes in and tears so many plants to bit. I'd go for things like Phormium, the New Zealand flax, which will thrive in a situation like that. Or one of those eryngiums, the ornamental thistles. Any of those will be really good. But what a beautiful garden you must have with fuchsia and Montbretia. I'm jealous. We like our gardens to be private. We like to shut away the street, the cars, the driveways, but it isn't always possible. Is it, Tina?
Yes, that's right.
So your driveway looks like Buckingham Palace.
Well, maybe from the outside. It's looking well today anyway.
And what? It's too in your face, is it?
It is, really, yeah. At this side of the house, it's kind of off the side of the kitchen, but it's not sheltered.
OK, if you use groups of trees there that you're seeing foliage that are like clouds in the sky with bare stems, that could take the look off the cars arriving up the driveway.
You don't want them going to the door.
Yes.
Right.
Who's that? Where's that voice coming from?
I've asked Mike to come and do it, but he's refusing. But yes, that's exactly it, because I want to do...
You want to block off from the house.
Come over and talk. Come on.
Come on, Mike.
We want the live, Mike.
How are you, Mike?
Very good. Fantastic. You see, we can see the door from here, OK?
Yeah.
So we don't want people looking in the door while I'm eating me dinner.
Would you not just move house?
That's the next option.
It's been thought about.
What you really need to do, you need to plant a mini forest.
But not big, huge trees.
Things like multi-stemmed feathered birch that will come out of the ground, five stems growing straight the way up. So you're just getting hints in and out, and it will give you that bank of privacy.
Yeah.
Okay.
Put them in.
In the middle of winter, when they're bare-rooted, they'll do that job for you. So it's a bit of an arboretum, a mini forest that you drive to before you get there.
Right, okay. That sounds good.
What's for dinner?
Spuds.
Put them on now and I'll be down. For many people, the gardens are wrapped up in emotional feelings, and for the lady I'm just about to talk to, her garden hasn't been created yet, and yet it's infused with emotion.
Hello.
Nicola,
where in the world are you?
I'm in Antrim. So we're in the countryside, but in a new build in the countryside.
And it means if you have a new build, you probably have a typical new build garden. Houses these days are generally boxes, and gardens are boxes. So you have
a nice square of grass.
Okay.
But I know your outdoor space really means something different to you. We all want gardens, but you want gardens for a very special reason, don't you, Nicola?
I moved into this house with my partner, Arne, in October, and then in February, he passed away in an accident. Because the inside of the house, he did it, and it's got him and his character and everything we chose together. Spring was to be the garden project, so he didn't get to do it. So I went to, well, hopefully you'll help me bring him into the garden so he's in the outdoor space too. Arne was fun-loving, outgoing, the most adventurous person ever. I really miss him in every way, but mostly because he was my other half. He always was here for us and looked after us.
Am I right in thinking that he spent time in France, and that has a huge influence on what he was planning to do this spring in the garden?
So he went and he lived in a little hamlet for 2 years in the French countryside, in a typical stone French, like a barn house, that kind of way. And there was roses grew up the side of the house, and it became then a really special place to us. So we would love to bring some French countryside into the garden.
Can you show me the roses that came from France?
Yes, I can do that. So they are here. They're in a little pot.
Oh, I hope they're okay.
No, oh, so do I.
You see the pot that they're sitting in, is there drainage through that pot, or are they sitting in water?
No, they're drainaged.
Oh, good, okay.
Let's keep them going until we get
them in the garden. So we want a little romantic French garden in Antrim, a place that's infused with memories.
With those roses and with little mementos that you brought back from France. And we'll achieve a garden that Arne would have loved.
And he'll still be in the garden, won't he?
Yeah, that's my dream.
The requirements from Nicola are to bring a place of joy, a place of memories, a place of symbols.
And to achieve the French theme, I've drawn up a lushly planted circular scheme which will make use of rustic materials.
I want to bring a little touch of that romantic town garden idea to Nicola's new home. I have to get it right. You know, you can set the tone of the garden or the style just by using a certain range of plants. For instance, in Nicola's garden, we want a French feel. So we're going for a very blousy, romantic, Mediterranean-type planting. If you wanted something exotic, though, I've got just the man to give us advice.
I really enjoy growing exotic plants in my garden because they give the impression of somewhere different. You know, I don't want to grow things that everybody else is growing. You can create an exotic garden anywhere. It doesn't have to be with tender plants. You can get the same look and the same impression by using hardy plants. You can use prehistoric tree ferns, and some of the native ferns can look quite exotic if they're mixed in with other large leaf foliage plants. And then you can add spots of colour using alstroemerias. Then you have salvias, which produce flowers all summer long. And then I'll also plant in amongst them with other tender plants, even some houseplants I plant out over the summer. So I'll use begonias, Rex begonias, and succulents that will all be planted out for, you know, from May to October. And they all work together to create sort of that sense of otherworldliness. There are three plants I would recommend for use in the exotic garden. Scheffler taiwaniana, which is a hardy umbrella plant. You often see the umbrella plant as a house plant, but this is a hardy version collected from high altitude in Taiwan, and it's been hardy for me down to -9°C, so it's quite a tough plant. Another one is Senecio angel wings, which has really large whitish-grey felted foliage, but it forms a spreading mat. I originally had one that was 8 to 10 foot across in my garden, and it was a standout plant in the garden. The final plant that I recommend are cannas. I grow them primarily for their foliage because they're quite late flowering, so they produce large strap-like leaves. They can be in purples or greens or variegated. And then in late summer, they'll produce spikes of tall orchid, almost gladiolus-like flowers. So for exotic colour in the garden, there's nothing quite like them to provide a real oomph. A lot of people are a bit scared of using exotics in the garden. You know, they're worried that they might lose them over the winter, but I think they're worth the gamble. If you get the conditions right in the first place and choose the right sort of plants, then the majority of them will grow well in our climate.
Absolutely love having water in a garden. I put three ponds into this design years ago, inspired by canals I saw at the Chelsea Flower Show. But I never quite got them right because I never planted them up and I never moved the water. It's time for a complete overhaul of the ponds and their borders. If you're planning to have a water feature or a pond in your garden like this, you must be sure what you want to achieve. First thing to consider is safety. If you have young children, they're really not suitable. The second thing is they can be brilliant for wildlife, but you must build them with shelves in them. They can be fantastic if you want to have a certain type of plants around them, marginal planting, which like the roots in moisture. And if you are planting, there's a number of different types of plants that are really important to have. The first is an oxygenator that goes in the water, looks a little bit like seaweed, and does what it says in the packet, it produces oxygen. Secondly, something floating on the top. You don't want sunlight going directly into the water. You want to block about half of it. What I plan to do is put some water jets and make water from this pond shoot into that one. It's going to be like the Bellagio in County Wicklow. I'm just about to give Nicola a buzz. James is up there to see how progress has been. James has been project managing all of the gardens this series, and I think when Nicola sees her design, she'll need his help.
Well, when we got the plants through, I absolutely adored them. They are everything and more that I wanted from the project. They really bring Arnie in to the whole garden, and that's exactly what I wanted. It was a bit emotional to see them. And then reality hit, and we realised they were actually very complicated plants. And so then I grafted in some extra help.
This way,
remember with Nicola, it's a very emotional garden that she had four roses that she brought over from France. They weren't looking good the last day. So let's see how progress is, and let's see if the roses are still alive.
Hi, Diarmuid.
I am so excited to see your garden.
Look at the big smile on you. Progress must be good.
There's plenty of progress here, Diarmuid.
How has Nicola
done, James? First,
she has done remarkably well, Diarmuid. There's been a huge transformation here. We're absolutely getting the foundations and the footings in for what's going to be a beautiful garden.
Nicola, there's one thing I'm really interested in. Can I see the roses?
They look a little unwell to me, but...
Oh, they're OK. They're OK.
They're OK.
Nicola, you see the cameramen that are in there beside you?
Yep.
Don't let them out without an axe, a pick, and a shovel.
That sounds like a plan. Everybody who comes in has to dig something to get out.
We might think in terms of colouring the fence.
A really, really dark blue, a grey slate or something like that, because I think planting would look great against that.
Wow, OK, yeah.
James, if you hang on there this evening and start painting.
Sorry, you're breaking up, Diarmuid.
Very good.
What does this red X button do, Nicola?
Okay. I think you're doing really great, but remember, this is one of the bigger jobs that we're tackling this year. Plenty of digging, plenty of painting, plenty of planting. Best of luck. You know, as a gardener, one of the most common questions I get asked is, how much water do I give my plants? How much water do you give your plants? Cara, plant scientist, over to you.
Often, people will have problem with their plants, and it might just simply be an issue with maybe a little bit too much water, or maybe not too much water. Funnily enough, not giving a plant enough water is less of a problem than overwatering your plants. And the reason for that is because a plant takes in and needs oxygen to carry out all its metabolic processes right down to the very last cell. It needs oxygen just like we need oxygen. But if you do overwater a plant, what happens is the root cells, they drown. They drown from lack of oxygen, basically. So you want to make sure that your soil that you're growing your plants in is nice and open, okay, and it's certainly not waterlogged. In fact, plant scientists like myself will say that it's better for a plant to be a little bit stressed. They actually do better. So think about not overwatering them so much, and then they'll be a little bit stressed, and they'll actually be happier for it. They'll thank you for it. You'll have better plants. What really fascinates me about plants is their diversity. They're just beautiful. But when you start to look at what a plant looks like microscopically, and it could be just something as simple as a very, very thin slice of a plant stem, there's huge diversity amongst plants, even down at a microscopic level too. So for instance, I'm looking down at a very, very thin section of a stem of Verbena bonarensis, and I can see the little red ridges around the edges. The colours are beautiful, and also I can see xylem vessels, which they're the water conducting cells. Sometimes I look down a microscope and I feel like I'm looking at artwork. It really is beautiful.
My new ponds are coming on well. They've been relined, stonework replaced, and now for my very favourite part, the planting.
Usually when I'm planting a garden, I would dig a hole and plant straight into the ground, but with a pond, it's ever so slightly different. We're just dealing with water. We still have pots, we still have compost in the pots, we have pebble in the top with a lot of them. But I want to develop an ecosystem here. So the first plant I'm going to put in is this thing here. It doesn't look like much, but it's really important. It's an oxygenator. That will go down, it'll float in the water, and it will produce lots of oxygen. The second plant that I'm going to introduce is a water lily. Water lilies are going to produce gorgeous flowers. I've always wanted to have them in my garden. But more importantly, these leaves are going to float at the top of the water, and they're going to cover at least half the surface of this water with cover. So the water won't discolour too easily. And the way I plant that is in a pot, which is really a basket. I have pebble at the top to keep the compost in there, and I'm gently going to let that fall down. Within a day or two, those will float over the water and then create a mass. The third type of plant that I want to put in is some sculptural or structural interest, and this kind of umbrella grass will do the job just fine. So I'm going to put 6 or 7 plants into this pond, and it'll be a beautiful habitat for plants and for wildlife. Lovely. Oh, I love this question from Fiona Rowley. As a complete novice, I'm looking to set plants, bulbs, etc. in an open new bed beside newly laid pebble patio. I love ornamental grasses and colour. Have you any suggestions? Well, maybe I do, but actually I know somebody who's going to have extraordinary suggestions, and that is Helen Dillon. Helen Dillon is the doyenne of gardeners worldwide. So I first met her 30 years ago.
Three really good plants that you must have. Hydrangea Pinky Winky, an annoying name but really pretty. Nice plant for colour for late summer. You must have Clematis ex durandii, which we all used to grow ages ago, and then people sort of forgot about it. They forget what a really good plant it is. It's particularly good because it doesn't get any kind of wilt. And finally, I absolutely love a dahlia called Carolina Moon, which is different than other dahlias, which are mostly sort of reds and purples and things like that. But this is the most delicious pink.
Right, now is the moment of truth for the water feature. I had these pumps left over from a project I did at the Chelsea Flower Show zonks ago. They're a bit Bellagio, they're a bit all singing, all dancing. What we're trying to do is have water hop. Yeah, you did hear that right, hop from this pond to that pond and then shoot all the way back here. Are you right, James?
Yep.
That's not pointed at me, is it? Okay, well, I can go. James! You want to see the grin on that face? Something quite nice about these arcs of water dancing from one pond to the next. Maybe it dazzles a little bit for this little garden. I don't know, we'll see. I do like what's happened with the pond. We've lined it with cubes of Kilkenny limestone, lovely planting outside it and fully planted inside. As it develops, it'll be a beautiful water garden. All the gardens we're doing in the series are really special, but Nicola's is very important to her. I'm hoping this little piece of the Mediterranean will fit right in. I'm quite nervous.
The garden's definitely peaceful and tranquil. It's just got memories in there now that weren't there before. It has definitely brought Arnie into the garden. It's been an emotional roller coaster, but we got there in the end and it's pretty magical.
Oh, that is amazing. Nicola.
Oh, no.
This is amazing. That's incredible. How did you do this?
With lots of family and friends. I absolutely love it. I can't believe we made it happen.
The cobbles, the lawn, and then the arch. You and Arnie moved into the house together.
Mm-hmm. He was a very special man. It's hard that he's not here to see it, but he would love her.
How are the roses?
Well, you tell me. They look like twigs to me, but they're still alive. That one?
Oh, yeah.
He looks good.
Doing really well.
Oh,
isn't that wonderful?
Mm-hmm.
And boys, I've brought you some furniture from my garden.
Wow.
The planting in general is very Mediterranean. We have this geranium, which is going to be just cheerful right the way through the summer. And against the white walls of the house, the building over here, that's going to sing. You have lavender over there in terracotta pots, and the Senecio called Angel's Wings for Arnie. And that's something
Perfect.
That Conrad in his garden told us all about. We have the really gorgeous inky violet African lilies there. Hydrangeas, which are late summer, and then these grasses. The idea is that you borrow the landscape beyond, so this becomes part of your garden, and it's a little bit of rural France in Northern Ireland.
It definitely is, yeah.
Well, I hope you have wonderful times here, making new wonderful memories. And I hope it's a place that you can come and talk to Arnie in peace and in solitude, surrounded by nature, surrounded by new plants, surrounded by lots of memories.